Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We'll give you guys a minute to log on, inshallah, and then we'll get started. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. So we're on the 27th day now. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our 27th night, which was last night. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to write down for us the reward of Laylatul Qadr. I hope that you guys felt like you were really in the zone last night, inshallah ta'ala. And don't forget that these other nights that are coming up are also precious. So, you know, we still have the 29th night ahead of us, inshallah ta'ala. And of course, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to worship equally on all 10 of these nights. So don't get too relaxed. I know that a lot of people like to quit after the 27th night and pretend that it's already Eid. It's not Eid yet. We still got a few days, inshallah. So keep it up, inshallah ta'ala. Also, just wanted to thank you guys that tuned into our VRIC fundraiser last night. Alhamdulillah, I know that it was a lot of fun, and I think we're close to our goal, inshallah. So if you'd like to, please just scroll right below this video, inshallah, and you'll see the video from the fundraiser last night. And you know, I'd appreciate if everyone pitched in something, everyone contributed something, inshallah ta'ala. So now we are juz 27, alhamdulillah, day 27, juz 27. As I said, these ajza, these last few chapters of the Quran, obviously include a lot of surahs because, you know, they're a lot shorter. The surahs are a lot shorter once we get into these last few juz of the Quran. And so we're going to try to cover as much as we can, inshallah ta'ala. So we start off with Surah Al-Tur. Surah Al-Tur is, and pretty much all of these surahs are either right before the hijrah or right after the hijrah. But inshallah ta'ala, I'll clarify the time frame whenever I get a chance. But Surah Al-Tur, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by the mountain of Al-Tur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by Al-Tur, He swears by the mountain of Al-Tur, He swears by Kitabin Mastur, He swears by the inscribed book, Firaqin Manshur, in a parchment that is unrolled and spread out, Wal Bayt Al-Ma'mur, and the house, which is, of course, now you can imagine the effect on the people of Mecca, because Baytul Ma'mur is the home that the angels go and they make tawaf around. 70,000 angels every day enter into Baytul Ma'mur, which is the equivalent of the Kaaba in the heavens, and they do tawaf and they never return after that. So every day 70,000 angels are going there. So Wal Baytul Ma'mur, the frequently visited house, was saqf al-marfu', and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and the roof that's raised high. And of course, the roof raised high here is referring to the heavens themselves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wal bahr al-masjur, and by the sea which is filled, kept filled. And some of the mufassirin said masjur here is referring to sujirat, whenever the seas will be filled with fire on the day of judgment. So they're filled with water now, but they will be filled with fire on the day of judgment. Inna عَذَابَ رَبِّكَ لَوَاقِعٌ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that verily the torment, the punishment of your Lord will come to pass. Now of course, just a few surahs after this is Surah Al-Waqi'ah, which is the details of that coming to pass. But Surah Al-Tur goes through some of the some of the scenes of the Day of Judgment, and you know, the punishment overtaking some people that, you know, refuse to pay attention to the mercy, to the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verse 17, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَنَعِيمٍ, that verily the muttaqeen, the pious, will be in gardens of Jannah and delight. And subhanAllah, we're going to see this phrase repeated frequently throughout the rest of the Qur'an. إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَعِيُونَ, or فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَنَعِيمٍ, or إِنَّ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ مَثَازَ. So this constant mention of the muttaqeen, those who are pious and those who are conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being in the state of delight and the state of paradise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised for them. فَاكِهِينَ بِمَا أَتَاهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ وَوَقَاهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ عَذَابَ الْجَحِيمِ. They are enjoying that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon them, and the fact that their Lord saved them from the torments of the blazing fire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the rewards of Jannah and so on and so forth. And I just want to fast forward. After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the rewards, the very specific rewards of Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings us to the people of paradise approaching one another once again. So in verse 25, وَأَقْبَلَ بَعْضُهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ يَتَسَاءَلُونَ. This is something that we've already covered, some of the conversations of paradise. But listen to this one, that some of them draw near to others and they start to speak, they start to question one another about some of the things that used to take place. In the previous revelation or the previous ayah that we came across, conversation, فَأَقْبَلَ بَعْضُهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ يَتَسَاءَلُونَ. The people of paradise gathered with one another, and one of them noticed that his friend was missing, or the person that used to call him away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was missing. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the people of paradise rejoicing with one another. So they're sort of remembering the struggles and the sacrifices that they made together, and how they feared the punishment that they were warned about, and they looked forward to the reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had promised them. And so they're sort of reminiscing. So قَالُوا إِنَّا كُنَّا قَبْلُ فِي أَهْلِنَا مُشْفِقِينَ. That, you know, we remember when we used to, along with our families, be afraid of the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we were amongst those people who were afraid of the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they say, فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا وَوَقَانَا عَذَابَ السَّمُومِ. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala conferred His favor, His grace upon us, and protected us from the punishment of the scorching fire. This, of course, was the ayah. If you look back at the series I did last year, People of Quran, this was the ayah that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha cried, reciting this ayah over and over and over and over again. Like, you imagine you're in Jannah and saying, you know, don't you guys remember when we used to talk about how much we feared the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us and He put us in this beautiful situation. Allah conferred His grace and His blessing upon us. So the reminiscing of the people of Jannah. Inna kunna min qablu nad'uhu. We remember, you know, before we used to supplicate Him. Remember, guys, when we used to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When we used to be in the masjid in the last 10 nights and we used to call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and constantly, you know, supplicate Him. Innahu huwa al-barru rahim. And indeed, it is He who is the most kind, the most courteous, and the most merciful. So, subhanAllah, there's this beautiful reminiscing that we see here that our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was extremely moved by. The message here is, of course, very much so consistent with Meccan Qur'an, and this goes with the rest of the Qur'an for the most part. You know, the belief in Allah, the belief in the hereafter, but this is a beautiful moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions of the believers gathering in paradise and basically saying to one another that it was worth it, right? That it was worth it. And that you know, everything that we went through in this world was absolutely worth it. And that's why the end of Surah At-Tur, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, really tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be patient and to hold firm to the message. And of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a way out for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and make a way out for his followers as well. So that's Surah At-Tur. The next surah is Surah An-Najm. And Surah An-Najm has a very powerful place in Islam, because Surah An-Najm is the surah which caused all of the people of Mecca to prostrate, all of the people of Mecca to fall into sujood. Surah An-Najm, to give you some context to it, Surah An-Najm was recited by the Prophet ﷺ publicly. He was leading Salah and he was reciting it publicly. A lot of people, of the people of Mecca, had made their way to Abyssinia. So this is after the first migration to Habasha, to Abyssinia, to escape persecution. And the Prophet ﷺ was reciting Surah An-Najm in front of the Kaaba. And when he was reciting Surah An-Najm in front of the Kaaba, all of the people were so moved by the power of the surah that they all fell in sujood, subhanAllah, except for Umayyah bin Khalaf, who was so arrogant that he just took some dirt and he put it on his forehead. So he didn't actually want to prostrate, but still even he was moved to take some dirt and put it on his forehead. So the rumor reached the people in Abyssinia that that these people now were, you know, were Muslims, that everyone had accepted Islam, that Quraysh had accepted Islam. So the Muslims in Abyssinia made their way back to Mecca, thinking that the people of Mecca had accepted Islam. But of course, once they came back, they saw that that was not actually the case. So subhanAllah, this was just a surah that was so powerful that it moved the people of Mecca to actually fall into sujood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ وَمَا غَوَى. Your companion Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has not strayed, nor has he erred. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى. Nor does he speak from his own desire, from his own inclination. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. Everything he says is only a revelation that's been revealed to him. عَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَى. He's been taught the Qur'an by the one who is mighty in power, meaning Jibreel alayhi salam. ذُو مِرَّةٍ فَاسْتَوَى. Jibreel alayhi salam, completely free from any defect in his creation, in his body, in his mind, in his soul, alayhi salam, fastawa. And so he rose in his true form to the horizon. So this refers to the first time that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saw Jibreel alayhi salam in his full form, where Jibreel alayhi salam filled up the entire horizon. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ بِالْأُفُقِ الْأَعْلَى. He was in the highest part of the horizon. ثُمَّ دَنَا فَتَدَلَّى. Then he approached the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he came close to him. فَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدْنَى. And he was at a distance of just two bow lengths or even nearer than that. فَأَوْحَى إِلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ مَا أَوْحَى. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam what he revealed. مَا كَذَبَ الْفُؤَادُ مَا رَأَى. The heart did not lie about what it saw, meaning the Prophet's heart did not deceive him. So subhanAllah, the people of Mecca are listening to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's words, that your companion is not deluded, your companion was not deceived. أَفَتُمَارُونَهُ عَلَى مَا يَرَى. Are you then going to dispute with him, with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about that which he saw? وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ نَزْلَةً أُخْرَى عِنْدَ سِدْرَةِ الْمُنْتَهَى. And he certainly saw him another time, a second time, عِنْدَ سِدْرَةَ الْمُنْتَهَى, at the lote tree, which is the highest boundary before Jannah. عِنْدَهَا جَنَّةُ الْمَأْوَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, near it is the paradise of abode, or the garden of refuge, and so on and so forth. So the point is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is stressing that your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not deluded, that he's not making any of this up, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing in vivid detail the way that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw Jibreel alayhi salam, and the way that the revelation comes to him, and everything that he says is a means of divine revelation. So there's this constant stress that's being put in Surah An-Najm on the truth of the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And how does this fall with a tur? And that which comes before, obviously At-Tur is warning the people of the time where they would all recognize that this is the truth, and Surah An-Najm is calling them to recognize the truth as it is right now. So this is the surah that caused the mushrikeen, that caused everyone to fall into sujood. Obviously if you go to the end of the surah, the very end of the surah is a sajda, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, censures the people that have that have called the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam a liar, and that have mocked the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah says, "Afa min hadha al-hadithi ta'jabun?" Do you then wonder at the recital of this Quran? Wa tadhhakuna wa la tabkun, and you laugh but you do not weep. Wa antum samidun, while you are proudly boasting and living your life in amusement. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands at the end of this surah to make sajda to him, to fall into prostration. And the tone of the surah is that powerful that it brought even these arrogant people to sajda. However, once they rose from that sajda, they still decided to fight the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They still decided to deny the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They still decided to remain firm in their opposition. Now, the reason why this is very important is because this surah basically proves that they knew that this was the truth. They knew that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was indeed a prophet and a messenger. And there are numerous narrations where they acknowledge that in private and in their gatherings. But at the same time, they did not want to accept that for reasons of tribalism and materialism and so on and so forth. So Allah established the proof against them through the Quran. The next surah is Surah Al-Qamar, which refers to the splitting of the moon. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala established the proof, first and foremost, the greatest miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the Qur'an. That's greater than all the other miracles that he performed. And it's the greatest favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions another proof that he established against them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qamar, اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ, that the hour has drawn near and the moon has split. The moon has split into two. And this, of course, refers to the people of Mecca challenging the Prophet ﷺ. They said that, you know what? If you are a prophet of Allah, then go ahead and split the moon into two. Show us that you can split the moon into two. And the Prophet ﷺ, he accepted that challenge by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They all met out and, you know, they all came out to see the Prophet ﷺ perform that miracle. He performed that miracle in front of them. And what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? وَإِنْ يَرَوْا آيَةً يُعْرِضُوا وَيَقُولُوا سِحْرٌ مُسْتَمِرٌ. And if they see any miracle, they turn away and they say that this is just continuous magic, that this is sihr, that the Prophet ﷺ is a sahir. So when the Qur'an is too good, they say he's a sha'ir, they say he's a poet. And when the people, when their people are affected by the Qur'an, they say he's a sorcerer. And when the Prophet ﷺ performs a miracle, they say he's a magician. So subhanAllah, depending on the miracle that the Prophet ﷺ performs in front of them, or depending on the sign that's presented before them, they have something to say each and every single time against the Prophet ﷺ. And obviously, you know, this is only a proof that is against them. And it proves that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not sent any shortage of miracles to the Prophet ﷺ. I mean, there are many miracles that were sent through him alayhi salatu wasalam, but they insist on turning away from these miracles, from these from this message that's been sent with the Prophet ﷺ. And then once again, when you get to the end of this surah, innal muttaqina fi jannatin wa nahar. So the same thing, the same message in Surah At-Tur, that verily the pious, those who feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and were in awe of him, they will be in the midst of gardens and rivers of paradise. فِي مَقْعَدِ صِدِقٍ عِنْدَ مَلِيكٍ مُقْتَدِرٍ. They will be in a seat of honor near the omnipotent king, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the owner of majesty and honor. SubhanAllah, they will be in a seat of honor near that omnipotent king, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who owns majesty, the one who is perfect in ability and perfect in his honor, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions his bringing near the muttaqeen in Surah Al-Qamar. Now obviously there are different levels, you know, for different people in their stations in Jannah. And in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, which is not the next surah but the surah after the next surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions as-sabiqoon, as-sabiqoon, ulaika al-muqarrabun, those who are brought closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the next surah after Surah An-Najm is Surah Ar-Rahman. And Surah Ar-Rahman is one of the first surahs revealed to the Prophet ﷺ. And in fact, Surah Ar-Rahman is the first surah that was ever recited publicly. That was recited publicly by Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And they almost killed Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu for reciting the Qur'an publicly, because he was not a man that had the protection of society. So Allah mentioned, if you look at these three surahs now in sequence, In Surah An-Najm, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the proof of Allah in the form of the Qur'an. In Surah Al-Qamar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the proof of Allah in the form of the miracles that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed other than the Qur'an. And in Surah Ar-Rahman, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ, which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? The favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us, the signs and the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانِ عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانِ, the most merciful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first favor of the most merciful is that he taught us the Qur'an. عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ, and then خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانِ, and then he created us, he created man. Now realize here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the greatest miracle of Allah is the Qur'an. Why? Or the greatest favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Qur'an. Why? Because had Allah created us without purpose, then our creation would be worthless. Our creation would be in vain. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us a purpose. He gave us guidance. He did not create us without any guidance and without any purpose. Instead, He gave us a purpose that we were born into. We are molded into that purpose. علم القرآن خلق الإنسان علمه البيان. He taught man how to express himself, how to eloquently express himself. الشمس والقمر بحسبان. The sun and the moon move by precise calculation. The previous surah is Surah Al-Qamar. It's not just the proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the Prophet ﷺ was able to split the moon in half. How about the orbit of the various systems that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put into place? When najmu wash-shajaru yasjudan, and the stars and the trees, they prostrate in ways that are in ways that are befitting to them, and in ways that that we cannot understand as human beings. وَالسَّمَاءَ رَفَعَهَا وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانِ, and the heaven He has raised high, and He has set up the balance. أَلَّا تَطْغَوْ فِي الْمِيزَانِ, that you should not transgress within the balance. وَأَقِيمُ الْوَزْنَ بِالْقِسْطِ وَلَا تُخْسِرُ الْمِيزَانِ, and establish weight and justice, and do not make the balance deficient. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to mention the various favors that He has bestowed upon us in this world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the favors that He would bestow upon us in Jannah as well. Of course, Surah Ar-Rahman is a beautiful, beautiful surah that is the favorite surah of many Muslims around the world, and constantly laced with فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمْ مَا تُكَذِّبَانِ, which one of the signs of your Lord will you deny? Now, the previous surah, Surah Al-Qamar, ended off with فِي مَقَعَدِ صِدْقٍ عِنْدَ مَلِيكٍ مُقْتَدِرٍ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would bring the muttaqeen, He would bring the believers, those who were pious and those who had awe of Him and fear of Him, He would put them in a seat of honor near the one who is Malik, who is the omnipotent king, Muqtadir, the owner of all honor and majesty. In the end of Surah Ar-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Tabarak ismu rabbika dhil jalali wal ikram, that blessed is the name of your Lord, the owner, the possessor of all majesty and all honor. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends off Surah Ar-Rahman in the same way that He ends off Surah Al-Qamar. And then, of course, after mentioning the three ways that He has established the proof against us, in the form of scripture, in the form of the Prophet ﷺ's miracles outside of that, in the form of the various favors and the signs that are inherently surrounding us and within us, after that comes Al-Waqi'ah, which is the inevitable. The inevitable event, which is the Day of Judgment. Okay, إِذَا وَقَعَتِ الْوَاقِعَةِ, then when the event, when that Day of Resurrection comes to pass, the one that you were warned about, the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told you was inevitable, it has now come to pass. And this is a surah, subhanAllah, that is, that has a tone, that should strike fear in the heart of anyone that fears the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but at the same time gives hope to those that look forward to being with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions these signs around us unfolding. Now realize in Surah Ar-Rahman, Allah gives us the scene of the sun, the moon, the heavens, the earth, the trees, the flowers, everything around us in its perfect balance. Surah Al-Waqi'ah is everything coming apart. Right, those favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and those signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those things around us all coming apart. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذَا رُجَّتِ الْأَرْضُ رَجَّ, the earth now is shaking with a terrible shake. It's an incredible earthquake that's taking place. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَبُسَّتِ الْجِبَالُ بَسَّ, and then the mountains are broken down, the mountains are reduced to mere dust. فَكَانَتْ هَبَاءً مُنْبَثَّ, and they will become like floating particles. So these mountains around you, they are now destroyed and they are floating particles, floating dust particles around you. وَكُنْتُمْ أَزْوَاجًا ثَلَاثًا, and at that point, you will be into three separate groups. At that point, you're in three separate groups. فَأَصْحَابُ الْمَيْمَنَةِ مَا أَصْحَابُ الْمَيْمَنَةِ, and so as for the companions of the right, and who are the companions of the right? وَأَصْحَابُ الْمَشْأَمَةِ مَا أَصْحَابُ الْمَشْأَمَةِ, and ask for the companions of the left, and who are the companions of the left? وَالسَّابِقُونَ السَّابِقُونَ, and those who are foremost in this world, in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will be foremost in Jannah as well. So the سَابِقُونَ in this dunya are the سَابِقُونَ in the akhirah as well. Those that used to rush towards those good deeds in this world, They will be rushed towards paradise in the next world. أُولَٰئِكَ الْمُقَرَّبُونَ And those are the ones who are brought near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala في جنات النعيم In the gardens of delight. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the way that we are divided once we come on the day of judgment. And of course, you know, it's the promise of Surah Ar-Rahman. The promise of Surah Ar-Rahman. That the believers will then move into their place and the things that are around us, the sun, the moon, everything around us that we thought was stable and that we depended upon its course and we did not, you know, thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala properly for, all of that starts to come apart. Now in Surah Ar-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that, he mentions that the greatest favor upon us is the Qur'an. Ar-Rahman, allama al-Qur'an. In Surah Al-Waqi'ah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he also starts to praise the Qur'an. He says, innahu laqur'anun kareem, that indeed this is an honorable, this is a noble Qur'an, fi kitabin maknoon, in a book that is well guarded with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah is referring to al-lawh al-mahfud, the preserved tablet, la yamassuhu illa al-mutahharoon, and that book that is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be touched except by those who are purified. Tanzeelun min Rabbil Alameen. Indeed, this is a revelation from the Lord of all of the worlds. Afa bihadha al-hadithi antum mudhinun. Then is it to this statement that you are indifferent? Are you denying and making yourselves indifferent to this message? And that's the end of the discourse about the Qur'an within the surah. But realize here that every one of these surahs is mentioning the Qur'an and mentioning the favor of the Qur'an. So in Surah Al-Najm, are you mocking this Qur'an? In Surah Al-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that this is the greatest favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you. And here once again in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that the Qur'an has been preserved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And no one will be able to, touch it except for the pure. And then now we have finally Surah Al-Hadid. And Surah Al-Hadid is a Madani surah. It's a Madani surah. So it's actually one of the Medina revelations, an early Medina revelations. And it starts off with سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ That whatsoever is in the heavens and the earth glorifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he is the Almighty and the All-Wise. So Surah Ar-Rahman, Allah mentioned the signs, the trees, the sun, the moon, the stars, everything around you, as a favor of Allah upon you. In Surah Al-Waqi'ah, Allah mentions all of that coming apart. In Surah Al-Hadid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions all of these things being in constant glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and constantly praising him and submitting themselves to him in ways that we cannot see. لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ يُحْيِي وَيُمِيتُ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ To him belongs the kingdom of the heavens and the earth. It is he who gives life and death, and he is able to do all things. هُوَ الْأَوَّلُ وَالْآخِرُ He is the first and the last. وَالظَّاهِرُ وَالْبَاطِنُ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most high and at the same time the most intimate. وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ And he is the knower of all things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the various favors upon us that he has bestowed in Surah Al-Hadid. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that he is with the believers. And Allah praises particularly those who rush to the message first. Okay? لَا يَسْتَوِي مِنْكُمْ مَنْ أَنْفَقَ مِنْ قَبْلِ الْفَتْحِ وَقَاتَلِ That those who accepted this message before the fatḥ, before the conquest, are far better than those who accepted it after the conquest. Now, what is this referring to? Now, realize that in the previous few surahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning the people of Mecca, primarily it's the people of Mecca, that have turned away. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that those who accepted Islam early on are greater than those who accepted Islam later on. Those who rushed to the message and accepted the message when it was inconvenient to do so, when it required much sacrifice, are far greater than those who accepted the message when it was now convenient and when it became the trend to accept the message. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that those sabiqoon, right, this is what Allah talked about in Al-Waqi'ah, as-sabiqoon, as-sabiqoon, that those sabiqoon, those who rushed first, are those who deserve the greatest reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أُولَٰئِكَ الْمُقَرَّبُونَ. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues along that same tone in Surah Al-Hadid, the exact verse number, verse 10, وَمَا لَكُمْ أَلَّا تُنْفِقُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلِلَّهِ مِيرَاثُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And why is it that you don't spend in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to Allah belongs the inheritance of the heavens and the earth. Not equal are those amongst you. لَا يَسْتَوِي مِنْكُمْ مَنْ أَنْفَقَ مِنْ قَبْلِ الْفَتْحِ وَقَاتَلْ. Not equal amongst you are those who spent before the conquest of Mecca and fought alongside the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. أُولَٰئِكَ أَعْظَمُ دَرَجَةً مِنَ الَّذِينَ أَنْفَقُوا مِنْ بَعْدُ وَقَاتَلُوا. They are far better than those who spent afterwards and fought. وَكُلًّا وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْحُسْنَى. But everyone will have their guaranteed reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what is in your hearts. He's very well acquainted with your intentions and with your hearts. The ulama say here that the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in particular is so that we can understand that even if you accepted Islam after Fatih Mecca, there will be some exceptions to the rule. There will be some people that accepted Islam late, but the way they accepted Islam, once they allowed it to enter their heart, is even greater than those that came before them. But for the most part, Allah praises those that came in before. Now, something very interesting here. The hypocrites did not appear in Islam, and the mention of the hypocrites did not appear in Islam until later on. Why? Because hypocrisy only took place when it was beneficial from a worldly perspective to be Muslim. So there was no mention of hypocrisy in Mecca, in early Mecca, because no one would have pretended to be Muslim for any worldly benefit or any worldly gain. But now, if you're living in Medina, and the Prophet ﷺ is in charge, or after Fatih Mecca, after the conquest of Mecca, and the Prophet ﷺ is in charge, there's something to benefit in a worldly sense, to portraying yourself to be Muslim, or to making yourself out to be a person who's devout and who's religious and so on and so forth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now mentions in Surah Al-Hadid a condemnation of hypocrisy. And Allah mentions on the Day of Judgment, وَيَوْمَ يَقُولُ الْمُنَافِقُونَ وَالْمُنَافِقَاتُ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. The day that the hypocrites from the men and the women would say to the believers, أُنظُرُونَا نَقْتَبِسْ مِنْ نُورِكُمْ. You know, wait for us so that we can take something from your light. Give us some of your light, because the Day of Judgment goes dark. And give us some of your light. And they see that the believers are going ahead. قِيلَ ارْجِعُوا وَرَاءَكُمْ فَالْتَمِسُوا نُورًا. And the believers would respond to the hypocrites, go back to the dunya and go ahead and kindle your light then. Because we worked on getting this light in the dunya. We kept ourselves busy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the sake of Allah. And we've been kindling this light because we knew that a day of darkness and the Day of Judgment would come. So you go back to the dunya, فَالْتَمِسُوا نُورًا, and you find a light. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَضُرِبَ بَيْنَهُمْ بِسُورٍ لَهُ بَابٍ. And then suddenly a barrier is put between them. بَاطِنُهُ فِيهِ الرَّحْمَةِ وَظَاهِرُهُ مِنْ قِبَلِهِ الْعَذَابِ. Inside of it is mercy, and outside of it is torment. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, يُنَادُونَهُمْ أَلَمْ نَكُنْ مَعَكُمْ. The hypocrites would call out and say, weren't we with you? We were amongst you. We used to pray just like you. We used to be amongst you as well. قَالُوا بَلَى وَلَكِنَّكُمْ فَتَنْتُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَتَرَبَّصْتُمْ وَارْتَبْتُمْ وَغَرَّتْكُمُ الْأَمَانِي حَتَّى جَاءَ أَمْرُ اللَّهِ وَغَرَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغَرُورِ. And they say, yes, but you tested yourselves and you awaited for that misfortune from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you had doubts in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and your wishful thinking deluded you until the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came and the chief deceiver deceived you, meaning shaitan. So you deluded yourselves by your wishful thinking, and the shaitan deluded you, and you constantly held back from going forth the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you to go forth, and you kept on dragging your feet until the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came. And so today there is nothing that you can do for yourselves to get yourselves out of the situation. Now subhanAllah, right after that, because you could read those verses and you could go, I'm in trouble. I know all these great people around me that have gone ahead, that have done far better than me. I know that I'm not as sincere as these other people around me. I know that I'm not doing the best that I can with my Islam. I know that my faith is not as good as it should be. I know that my private practice does not match my public practice. I know that people think of me in a certain way, but I'm not really the way that they think of me. All of these different things of despair. You know, I missed my chance. I missed my opportunity. I remember this person used to call me and tell me to be more religious, but I wasn't as religious as I should have been, and so on and so forth. You know, this person surpassed me. لا يستوي منكم من أنفق من قبل الفتح وقاتل, right? Those are people that preceded me. I have no chance now. I've already ruined myself. I've already soiled myself. Here we go in verse 16. أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. Isn't it time for those who believe to humble their hearts to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the truth which He has revealed? Isn't it time now? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stops you in your thought process and says, isn't it time for you now to change? You're hearing about the hypocrites and those that came early and those that came late, and you've dragged your feet for too long in committing yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way that you're capable of committing yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So isn't it time now for you to submit yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Isn't it time to really humble your hearts to the dhikr of Allah, to the remembrance of Allah, to the Qur'an? وَمَا نَزْلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. We've been talking about how great the Qur'an is. You know the Qur'an is great. You know it's divine revelation. So shouldn't you now humble yourself to it? Shouldn't you now act in accordance with it? Shouldn't you now submit yourself? وَلَا يَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِ فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدُ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. And don't be like those who came before you, the people of the scripture that came before you, who they had those moments of realization, but time passed between those moments of realization and them implementing a system of practice and change and dedication, a solid plan to keep themselves firm on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so their hearts hardened once again. So it's not enough to just have that realization. You need to commit yourself now to the program that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has highlighted to us in the Quran and in the Sunnah. Finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اِعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُحْيِي الْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا قَدْ بَيَّنَّا لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. Know that Allah gives life to the earth after its lifelessness. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives life to the earth after its death, and we have made clear the ayat, the signs to you, if only you would understand. If only you'd pay attention and understand. Now, why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about reviving dead land? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends rain and He revives dead land. Because Allah is saying, even if your hearts are dead, even if your hearts are dead, they can be resuscitated. But you need spiritual CPR now. Like, you've really, really gone far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you really need to change, but it's not impossible. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hasn't given up on you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you the Quran from the heavens as He sent rain to give life to the earth after its death. He sent revelation, divine revelation from the heavens to give life to dead hearts. Sick hearts, dead hearts, whatever they are, you can come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a way out for you, but you need to commit yourself. So don't despair, you need to commit yourself. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those that humble ourselves to this revelation that He has made easy for us, that is the greatest favor upon us, that is the greatest miracle that's been sent to us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those that submit to the truth, that die in the best state, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us husn al-khitam, the best state, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts our siyam, our fasting, our qiyam, our tilawat al-Qur'an, everything that we've done in this month and beyond, inshallah. So, jazakumullahu khairan for tuning in. Just a few more days, inshallah ta'ala, of Ramadan. We've got three more juz to cover. The charity today is actually kind of untraditional. You know, one of the classes actually, you know, that I've been teaching is behind the scenes with Al Maghrib Institute, which is a class in tazkiyah. And alhamdulillah, Al Maghrib Institute is an institute that's done wonderful, wonderful things, that's held seminars around the world, mashallah. And people have really changed their lives through the seminars that have been taught with Al Maghrib. And one of the policies of Al-Maghrib is never to turn away someone who can't afford to attend the class. There's a scholarship fund. And you can imagine when you invest in people that, you know, that to change their lives, whether whatever educational institute it is, inshallah ta'ala, that's a benefit for you, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. So inshallah, I'm going to post a link for the scholarship fund of Al-Maghrib so that you can sponsor students, inshallah ta'ala, to take these classes, these seminars, so that hopefully they could have their lives changed as well, inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept. Jazakumullahu khairan. I'll see you all tomorrow, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.